Hey everybody, Brion McClanahan here. The woke madness in history education is off the rails. Well, how do we change it? McClanahanacademy.com. And because you listen to this podcast, if you use the coupon code PODCAST at checkout, you get 25% off every day, all day, 365 days a year on every class at McClanahanacademy.com. So go to McClanahanacademy.com, use coupon code PODCAST at checkout, and get a real history education at 25% off. If you like this podcast and you want it without advertisements, head over to patreon.com and become a member of the Brion McClanahan Show. For $10 a month, you get all the podcasts ad-free, including video, and you also get a special Q&A podcast. I'm only going to answer your questions, your listener-generated episodes, through those Q&As. So, head over to patreon.com, get this podcast ad-free, no ads, not even things like this, and you really do help support the Brion McClanahan Show with really cool stuff on the back end. Did Abraham Lincoln screw up America? Absolutely. So did a litany of other presidents, and I've got all of them in 9 Presidents Who Screwed Up America. It's one of my favorite books that I've written. You're really going to love it, and you might even be shocked about who I include in those 9 presidents, including Abraham Lincoln. Pick it up wherever books are sold online. I guarantee you'll love it. Kamala Harris and Tim Walz gave the most disastrous interview ever on 60 Minutes. I'll talk about that on this episode of The Brion McClanahan Show.
It's time to think locally and act locally. Welcome to The Brion McClanahan Show.
Glenn Show, glad to be back on the program. Very glad to be here. All right, well, if you haven't seen it, you should. You can go out and watch the 60 Minutes interview with Kamala Harris and Tim Walz. It's an abject disaster, as you might expect, because Harris, of course, could not be on script. Walz is terrible. But I want to talk about it because it does show that these people really don't have any clue as to what they're doing. In fact, what we've seen from the Democrats recently is that they're saying Trump, of course, is some kind of front man for this conspiracy to take over America and in part despotism or tyranny on the United States. We're going to shred the Constitution, that there's some kind of group, this anonymous Project 2025 that's going to destroy democracy. But what they're really doing there is projecting, because this is exactly what the Democrats do all the time. In fact, you could say that Biden really hasn't been in charge of anything. He's admitted it. Kamala Harris is right there making decisions every time I made a decision. In other words, Kamala Harris is making decisions. And who was really making decisions? Not Kamala Harris, but, of course, Barack Obama. He's openly admitted before that after he left office, if he could sit in the basement with an earpiece and some type of communication device, he would still run the country. This is what makes all of this very strange to me, because, of course, Obama could have just suggested they put Michelle in instead of Kamala Harris. But I think that the problem with that, of course, is that they would be seen as too power-hungry at that point because Harris is there, and I think they want her to fail. I've said this before. I think that the Obamas want Kamala Harris to fail. They want Donald Trump to come into office, and they're hoping that Trump's 4 years in office will be a disaster, and they can ride in on the white horse and save the day in 2028. Of course, they won't be saving anything. They'll be destroying stuff. But Joe Biden, I think, is in some ways trying to sabotage Kamala Harris. I really do think Joe Biden is proud of his administration. I don't think that he believes his administration is bad, that he's done anything wrong. I think he believes he's had this whole list of things that are proud accomplishments, and if he thinks he's putting them on Kamala Harris, that's actually benefiting her. But people know that by doing this, he's essentially admitting that she led the coup that got him out of power. And in fact, this 60 Minutes interview brings that up. It's not in the article I'm going to read, but they address this in the interview. Oh, wait a second here. You make a point that we should believe you. But you didn't really get elected to anything. You were appointed to this. How do we know that you're going to protect democracy when you were appointed? Well, I got a lot of delegates, and Joe Biden is going to be seen as heroic for stepping down. No, he's not. Everyone with a brain can see what this was. It was a coup by the Obamas and Harris to get rid of Joe Biden. And, of course, Joe Biden wasn't really ever fit to be president to begin with. His mental acumen was probably a little bit better 4 years ago, but in the last, say, 2 years, maybe even 3 years, it's really slipped. Certainly in the last 2 years. So, the fact is, the Democrats wanted a figurehead. They got Joe Biden. He wanted to be president since he was a teenager. And so, he was willing to do it. I'm not so certain Kamala Harris isn't the same way. She just wants to be president of the United States. First female president, this is what she wants. And so if she could just be a figurehead, she would do it. She's an empty suit. Anytime she's off script, she's terrible. And when they ask tough questions, she can't answer them because she doesn't really know the answers to these questions. She knows there's major problems in her campaign. There's major holes in her story. And she's fake. As I said on the podcast where I discussed Tim Walz and the vice presidential debates, Walz is terrible. And I want to make that clear. Some people were confused, like I was supporting Tim Walz or something. No, Walz is awful. But in terms of authenticity, he's more authentic than Kamala Harris. Every day of the week, you can believe that he's from the Midwest. You can't really believe what he says because, of course, he lies. We know that. It's on record. He's a liar about his military record, about where he was in China. I mean, there's things that he's lied and lied and lied about. And of course, as governor of Minnesota, his record clearly shows he's not a centrist. He's a far left progressive. And same thing with Kamala Harris. That's what you're getting when you elect these people. And I will give credit to CBS. They actually pegged her on this. Hey, you've said this and then you did this and you've said this. And I'm going to talk about that because her answers are non-answers. She can't really answer these things. And when they ask her questions, well, how are you going to bring all these Trump people into the fold? She can't. She'll just point to someone like Liz Cheney. And CBS tried to save her with that. Well, we got Liz Cheney supporting Kamala Harris. And so that shows that there's a lot of people. She's in the birthplace of the Republican Party in Wisconsin. That shows a lot of people support Kamala Harris. Those are establishment people. They're the uniparty people. They would have supported her no matter what. You see, that's the real dirty secret. This has been discussed since the 1960s. We've had a uniparty for a long time. It's amazing when the Democrats now are running for the support of Dick Cheney and hoping George W. Bush somehow comes in and says he's going to vote for Kamala Harris or Kamala Harris or whatever you want to call her. Because, well, that means more Republicans support the centrists. And I remember back when Bush was president, I was stupidly on a left-wing website that had a message board. And I went on and said, yeah, I don't understand. Or I posted a comment, something like that. And I said, I don't understand, y'all. It's George W. Bush is your guy. Oh, they lost their marbles. But this is exactly what progressives are looking for now because they're admitting George W. Bush was their guy. You see? George W. Bush is a progressive. Dick Cheney is a progressive. Liz Cheney is a progressive. Mitt Romney is a progressive. All of these people that have now pledged their fealty to Kamala Harris are progressives. They're war parties. They are the warfare state. This is what these people are. And of course, Harris offers that beautiful pie in the sky of war with everybody in the world. And this was brought up with CBS again. I will give CBS credit for giving a tough interview. I mean, this was amazing if you watch it. And I mean, you just go on CBS and they have the replay of it. But Bill Whitaker did a fantastic job in asking some really tough questions. Now, of course, Trump dodged the CBS interview and of course, they were critical of Trump for doing that. But Trump has already been asked these tough questions. He's already been on a debate where it was essentially four against one. I mean, or three against one, I should say, whatever it was. However many moderators we had. Trump's already done that with Harris. We've already seen J.D. Vance do that. We've already seen this story where Trump has had the entire stage against him. It doesn't need to be done. But what's really funny is I think that the left is showing you that they don't like Harris. They're not really on board with Harris. And I think that's the the thing to take away from this. They don't really want her. They know she's a poor candidate and that there are a lot of holes in her story. And I'm going to get to where I think she's lying about some things. All right, so let me just get into the piece. This is at CBSNews.com. Title, Kamala Harris Makes the Case in 60 Minutes Interview for Why She Should Be President. Again, by Bill Whitaker. Kamala Harris has been a candidate for president for just 2.5 months, and the post-convention honeymoon is over. In fact, her poll numbers, I've seen various stories about this, are tanking. Some I've seen where they're increasing, others I've seen they're tanking. It really doesn't matter. The most accurate poll has Trump winning. The most accurate poll in 2020 and 2022 has Trump winning the election. Right now, Trump is winning the election. And I think in some of these states, like Pennsylvania and Wisconsin and Ohio and Georgia. Now, Georgia is going to be interesting with the storm. And, of course, Florida, now that they're going to get battered with another storm, it's going through an area that isn't really pro-Trump. How is that going to affect voter turnout for that state? I mean, I don't know. Unfortunately, it's how is it going to affect voter turnout? You know, the Asheville area is actually very much a pro-Harris area. It's pretty left-wing. But you do have the people in the rural areas that were affected by it, too. We'll see if that plays out in North Carolina, Georgia, or Florida, and how that affects the election. But again, you know, Trump is going for these areas, Wisconsin, that he won in 2016. He supposedly narrowly lost in 2020. And again, I mean, the numbers say he lost. Were there some irregularities? Probably so. Can they prove it? No. That's the issue. But he's going, I mean, if we have a real election in 2024, which it looks like we're going to have, with, I mean, barring anything catastrophic in the next little less than a month, it looks like we're going to have a pretty normal election. I don't think Trump loses. And so it'll be interesting how the left reacts to that. Now, I mean, Trump could lose. And that's a possibility still. I mean, look, half the population has already made up their mind. It's going to come down to several thousand people in each one of these states and what they want to do, which is why they're spending a lot of time there. But again, I think 60 Minutes just did a really damaging interview for Kamala Harris. And I'm sure that the left is just really upset about this because it's back to the report by the FBI that threw Hillary Clinton under the bus back in October of 2016. They're back to that. They're not circling the wagons enough. I mean, they're actually asking tough questions. But the race does remain extremely close, as the piece says. The honeymoon, though, is over. I mean, I think Harris is really sagging in the polls. With the election just 29 days away, Harris and her running mate, Minnesota Governor Tim Walz, face unrelenting attacks from Donald Trump, and the race remains extremely close. I think it's going to go Trump's way. We met the 59-year-old vice president this past week on the campaign trail and later at the vice president's residence in Washington, D.C. We spoke about the economy and immigration, Ukraine and China, but we began with the escalating war in the Middle East 1 year after the Hamas terror attack on Israel. Whitaker said, the events of the past few weeks have pushed us to the brink, if not to an all-out regional war in the Middle East. What can the U.S. do at this point to stop this from spiraling out of control? Harris says, well, I was born in a middle-class family, and people mowed their lawns. No, that's not what she said. But that's kind of what she said. In fact, I think this is really interesting. CBS is asking a really important question here. They start with foreign policy because it's the most important thing the president can do. Trump is on record. He's going to solve these wars. When he was president, we didn't have this kind of stuff. And he has a record to show it. Harris does not. The Biden administration does not. Now, one thing Biden did accomplish as president recently is he pushed off this longshoreman strike till after the election. Kind of threatened, to say the least. These people are mostly Democrats, so look, you got to keep this going because if you do this, it's going to destroy the Democrats entirely. So they went ahead and pushed it back. But the fact is, this is the most important thing the president can do. And the Biden administration has been an abject disaster. We've got an escalating war in Ukraine. We've got an escalating war in the Middle East. The warfare party is all over it. And Harris doubles down. Harris, well, let's start with October 7th. 1,200 people were massacred. 250 hostages were taken, including Americans. And as I said then, I maintain Israel has a right to defend itself. We would. And how it does so matters. For far too many innocent Palestinians have been killed. This war has to end. So Whitaker says, well, we supply Israel with billions of dollars in military aid. And yet Prime Minister Netanyahu seems to be charting his own course. The Biden-Harris administration has pressed him to agree to a ceasefire. He's resisted. You urged him not to go into Lebanon. He went anyways. Does the U.S. have no sway over Prime Minister Netanyahu? Harris says, the work that we do diplomatically with the leadership of Israel is an ongoing pursuit around making clear our principles. So in other words, one of the most idiotic non-answers ever. So, well, Israel's right to defend itself, and but how they do so matters. So Whitaker says, well, we give them lots of money. We send them all their military equipment. You would think that they would do what we say, but they're not listening to you. In other words, you're incompetent. Well, our diplomacy is we have to make clear. Whitaker says, but it seems that Prime Minister Netanyahu is not listening. Harris, we are not going to stop pursuing what is necessary for the United States to be clear about where we stand on the need for this war to end. Whitaker says, do we have a real close ally in Prime Minister Netanyahu? So in other words, you're making your points clear, but he's not listening. He doesn't respect you, in other words. I mean, what came out of this is the Israeli government doesn't respect you. There's no respect for Biden. There's no respect for Harris. And if you are involved in the briefing room, if you're right there, as Biden has said, he clearly doesn't respect you. This is a disaster of an answer. So then Harris says, I think with all due respect, she got irritated with him because he kept saying, well, they're not, without saying it, he's saying they don't respect you. With all due respect, she already put herself in a subservient position right there. She is the person running to be president of the United States. And she's saying, with all due respect to a reporter, can you imagine Biden taking that stance? Trump taking that stance? Obama taking that stance? Clinton taking that stance? Saying to a reporter, with all due respect, no. She just wilted in that one line. Her body language, when you watch this, is horrible. She doesn't know what she's doing. So, with all due respect to a reporter, all she had to say is, I think the better question is, I mean, kind of like, hey, shut up, Whitaker. But she didn't do that. She didn't show any authority or confidence. She put herself back with that kind of answer. It's amazing what a little bit of language will tell you. The better question is, do we have an important alliance between the American people and the Israeli people? And the answer to that question is yes. So in other words, they don't have a good relationship with Israel. Israel doesn't respect the United States or their position. Israel's going to do what Israel wants. The United States has no control over it, even though we send them, as Bill Whitaker says, all this billions of dollars in military aid. You would think that we control them, but you're not controlling them. If you don't want to have a war, we'll tell them to stop, and they're not doing it. Well, with all due respect, the Israeli people and the American people are aligned. What an idiotic non-answer. So again, foreign policy, she's a failure. She can't negotiate. She just wilted under the pressure of a reporter. Imagine what happens if she's sitting there with world leaders. There's been some pretty damning information come out about Harris as a prosecutor, right? She's never really argued a case in court, ever. There's no evidence she's ever appeared before a court and argued the case. Damning. She can't do it. She did fail the bar exam. She can't do it. So the piece says, while the war in the Middle East has dominated recent headlines, it's the economy that most concerns American voters this election year, as always. Whitaker says, there are lots of signs that the American economy is doing very well, better than most countries, I think. But the American people don't seem to be feeling it. Groceries are 25% higher, and people are blaming you and Joe Biden for that. Are they wrong? Well, I was born in a middle-class family. No, that's not what she said. Again, every time, because of that answer, you're going to think about it. So Harris says, we now have historic low unemployment in America among all groups of people. Well, the crazy thing about unemployment is they don't actually count it. They don't tally it the way they used to. Was it really historic low? Because they don't really count a huge number of people who just stopped looking for jobs and or part-time jobs, underemployed. They don't count that anymore. So they're only looking at a certain metric, and we don't really have historic low unemployment. We now have an economy that is thriving by all macroeconomic measures. And to your point, prices are still too high. And I know that. We need a plan to deal with it, which is why part of my plan, you mentioned groceries, part of my plan is what we must do to bring down the price of groceries. Well, we could just stop printing money. That would be a good thing. But, of course, she doesn't say that. Harris says she'll press Congress to pass a federal ban on price gouging for food and groceries, but details are not yet to be defined. Yeah, because, well, there is no plan. The plan should be, let's cut spending and let's get some of this money out of the economy. Let's get some of the cash out. We need to cut government spending. That's how you solve an inflationary spiral. I mean, you can't keep printing money. But that's not what they're going to do. We're going to attack grocery stores, which already have a profit margin of near zero, to be frank. We're going to go after those people. Because they're supposed to, they're price gouging. I mean, how ridiculous of an answer is this? It's a non-answer. And as Harris says, well, details are yet to be defined because there aren't any details. Bill Whitaker, you want to expand the child tax credit. Harris, yes, I do. You want to give tax breaks to first-time homebuyers? Yes. And people starting small businesses? Correct. And then this is funny. But it's estimated by the Nonpartisan Committee for Responsible Federal Budget that your economic plan would add $3 trillion to the federal deficit over the next decade. How are you going to pay for that? So when you talk about inflation, well, when you spend more money, you're going to get more inflation. This is what he's asking her. Well, how are you going to pay for it? And this is where she starts fumbling and stumbling. So the other economists that have reviewed my plan versus my opponent determined that my economic plan would strengthen America's economy. His plan would weaken it. But my plan, Bill, if you don't mind, now she's trying to butt in here, I'm speaking. He's trying to say, but that's not the question I asked you, and he's going to say that. My plan is about saying that when you invest in small businesses, you invest in the middle class, and you strengthen America's economy, small businesses are part of the backbone of America's economy. This is like a George H.W. Bush answer when he was asked in a debate with both Perot and Clinton, what are you going to do to pay for that? Or what are you going to do about the debt? I don't know. When I invest in things. It's exactly George H.W. Bush. Deer in the headlights. And then Whitaker says, but pardon me, Madam Vice President, the question was, how are you going to pay for it? How are you going to pay for it? That's not what he asked you. He didn't ask you all this nonsense. How are you going to pay for it? Well, because you're going to add $3 trillion to the deficit, which of course, over the next decade, which of course is going to cause more inflation. Well, one of the things I'm going to make sure is that the richest among us who can afford it pay their fair share in taxes. It's not right that teachers and nurses and firefighters are paying a higher tax and rate than billionaires and the biggest corporations. And Whitaker starts saying, but I'm planning on making that fair. But we're dealing with the real world here, Whitaker says. But the real world includes, well, how are you going to get this through Congress? So how are you going to, you can't just do this. See, and he asks the real question. The actual question. So I'm going to lower taxes. I'm going to raise taxes. Okay. So you don't actually raise and lower taxes. When you talk quietly with a lot of folks in Congress, they know exactly what I'm talking about because their constituents know exactly what I'm talking about. Really? This is their answer. They know exactly what I'm talking about because their constituents know exactly what I'm talking about. What are you talking about? Their constituents are those firefighters and teachers and nurses. Their constituents are middle-class, hardworking folk. She's trying to pull the populist Barack Obama folk say. And Whitaker says, and Congress has shown no inclination to move in your direction. Yeah, so Congress isn't going to... Now, they're hoping that they can win Congress so that they can actually do this stuff. I mean, that's the dirty little secret. Harris says, well, I disagree with you. There are plenty of leaders in Congress who understand and know that the Trump tax cuts, Texas, blew up our federal deficit. None of us, and certainly I can't afford to be myopic in terms of how I think about strengthening America's economy. What does that even mean? Let me tell you something. I'm a devout public servant. You know that I'm also a capitalist, and I know the limitations of government. Huh? What a weird answer. In other words, she doesn't have a clue. She doesn't know what she's going to do here. She knows she doesn't have any power to do any of this stuff. Kamala Harris wants power. She doesn't know any. I mean, this is just ridiculously stupid. And then, of course, Whitaker says, or the piece says, Kamala Harris has been in government for decades. She was first elected San Francisco District Attorney in 2003, then California Attorney General, and she went on to the United States Senate and now Vice President. Whitaker says, a number of registered voters say they still don't know you. They don't know what makes you tick, and why do you think that is? What's the disconnect? Harris says, it's an election, Bill, and I take it seriously that I have to earn everyone's vote. This is an election for President of the United States. No one should be able to take for granted that they just can declare themselves a candidate and automatically receive support. You have to earn it. That's what I intend to do. Now, the funny thing is, this is exactly what she did. No one should be able to take for granted that they can just declare themselves a candidate and automatically receive support. Well, this is what she did. We're saved democracy, but she declared herself a candidate and automatically received support. It's exactly what she's hoped. It's exactly what's happened. She's just explained the whole situation. Hilarious. Hilarious. So Whitaker says, let me tell you what your critics and the columnists say. Okay, she says. They say the reason so many voters don't know you is that you've changed your position on so many things. You were against fracking, now you're for it. You supported looser immigration policies, now you're tightening them up. You were for Medicaid for all, now you're not. So many people that people don't truly know what you believe or what you stand for, and I know you've heard that. Well, Harris says, in the last 4 years, I've been Vice President of the United States. Really? No way. This is their answer. Well, in the last 4 years, I've been Vice President of the United States. Really? We didn't know. We didn't know this was happening. And I've been traveling our country. Really? And I have been listening to folks and seeking what is possible in terms of common ground. Seeking what is possible. I believe in building consensus. We're a diverse people. Look at this non-answer. Geographically, regionally, in terms of where we are in our backgrounds. And what the American people do want is that we have leaders who can build consensus, where we can figure out compromise and understand it's not a bad thing as long as you don't compromise your values, to find common sense solutions, and that has been my approach. No, it hasn't. You've cast a deciding vote on bills that were so far left that they couldn't get any bipartisan support. That's not consensus. That's power. You see? That's power. You don't believe any of this stuff. It's the voters are saying, well, I don't know what you believe. She's lying, in other words. And of course, Walz is doing the same thing. So Whitaker says, you recently visited the border and embraced President Biden's recent crackdown on asylum seekers. And that crackdown produced an almost immediate and dramatic decrease in the number of border crossings. If that's the right answer now, why didn't your administration take those steps in 2021? So, if this is the right thing now, why didn't you do it 3 years ago? So, her answer. The first bill we proposed to Congress was to fix our broken immigration system, knowing that if you want to actually fix it, we need Congress to act. It was not taken up. Fast forward to a moment when a bipartisan group of members of the United States Senate, including one of the most conservative members of the United States Senate, got together, came up with the border security bill. Well, guess what happened? Donald Trump got word that this bill was afoot and could be passed, and he wants to run on a problem instead of fixing a problem. So he told his buddy in Congress, kill the bill. Don't let it move forward. So then Whitaker says, well, wait a second here. I've been covering the border for years. I know this is not a problem that started with your administration. Correct, Harris says. But there was a historic flood of undocumented immigrants coming across the border the first 3 years of your administration. As a matter of fact, arrivals quadrupled from the last year of President Trump. Was it a mistake to loosen the immigration policies as much as you did? And of course, they did. Biden went in and used an executive order to kill every Trump-era restriction on immigration. So he's saying, if this is the right move now, why didn't you do it in 2021? Well, it's a long-standing problem and solutions are at hand. And from day one, literally, we have been offering solutions. You have? You opened the border. He says, well, what I was asking is, was it a mistake to kind of allow that flood to happen in the first place? And then Harris gets really flustered. I think the policies that I've been proposing are about fixing a problem, not promoting a problem. Okay, but the numbers did quadruple under your, and the numbers today under your watch. And she says, because what we have done, we've cut the flow of illegal immigration by half. Half of what? From when you opened it up? So it's still more than it was? I mean, give me a break. But you should have done that. He says, you should have done that when you came into office. Right? This is the thing. Look, this is a disaster for Harris. There's no way, if anybody watched this, she could recover. These people are on her side, and the left. Now, I know the left is going to spin this. Whoa, we've got a hostile media against us. And maybe that's what they're trying to show here. I mean, Bill Whitaker is somehow some right-winger. I mean, look, this is a disaster. An abject disaster for Kamala Harris and Tim Walz. There's no way they can really recover from this. Then, of course, he says, you know, Donald Trump's been said, you've accused Donald Trump of using racist tropes. You've called Trump racist and divisive. Yet Donald Trump has the support of millions and millions of Americans. How do you explain that? So you're calling all these Trump people racist. Well, how do you explain this? She says, I'm glad you're pointing out these comments that he made that have resulted in a response by most reasonable people to say, that's just wrong, it's just wrong. But he says, with so many people supporting Donald Trump, a man you have called racist, how do you bridge that seemingly unbridgeable gap? How do you have Joe Biden stand up and say, you know, these people are awful, MAGA is a threat to the United States? How do you bridge that gap? She can't. She doesn't really have an answer for that. And then, of course, they have an interview with Liz Cheney and other things. But the other part that I found hilarious, of course, she gets into Ukraine, you know, she gets into the issue with Ukraine, a non-answer. She can't really come up with a solution to what would happen in Ukraine. Whitaker asks, would you meet with President Vladimir Putin? No, not bilateral, that Ukraine. No, Ukraine must have a say in the future of Ukraine. As president, would you support the effort to expand NATO to include Ukraine? Those are all issues that we'll deal with if and when it arrives at that point. In other words, yes. That was an answer of yes. And of course, that's a non-starter for any negotiations. And then he says, a hard left turn here, but you recently surprised people when you said that you're a gun owner and that if someone came into your house, that's not the first time I've talked about it. So he says, so what kind of gun do you own and when and why did you get it? I have a Glock. She just came up with whatever she could come up with. What's a popular gun brand manufacturer? A Glock. I have a Glock and I've had it for quite some time. Really? And look, I mean, look, Bill, my background is in law enforcement, and there you go. Have you ever fired it? Yes, of course I have, at a shooting range. Yes, of course I have. What kind is it? If you are a gun owner, you would know. You would actually say, well, this is the type of firearm I have. Yeah, I have a Glock 9mm, 45, whatever it is. Even just the caliber that you would have. You don't have to give the model, but the caliber that you have. She doesn't even know. She doesn't know. Because she doesn't have one. I can guarantee you. She doesn't have one. And if they pressed her on it, she would go get one very quickly. But there's going to be no proof that she has this firearm. Zero. I mean, I think California has some type of gun registration. So it might be on the record if she does or not. I have no idea. But that's where she would have it. So somebody could maybe go out and try to find this information. If they can't find it, well, then where did she get it? Right? So this is funny. And then, of course, you get to Walz. And Whitaker gives him this one. He says, your debate with J.D. Vance, you said, I'm a knucklehead at times, and I think you're referring to that time that you said you were in Hong Kong during the Tiananmen Square unrest when you were not. Yeah. Is that kind of misrepresentation? Isn't that more than just being a knucklehead? He says, I think folks know who I am, and I think they know the difference between someone expressing emotion and telling a story and getting a date wrong, rather than a pathological liar like Donald Trump. And then Whitaker says, but I think it comes down to a question of whether you can be trusted to tell the truth. Well, I can. I think I can. Well, but you don't really tell the truth about anything. And so, I mean, that was really funny. And he asks about, you know, being a radical leftist. Well, referring to your children get breakfast and lunch in school so they can learn. He may be talking about we had paid family medical leave policy that was promoted by the business community. Donald Trump spends his time tearing down states rather than lifting up the things we do, the best of it. Donald Trump critiques of that, not only are that they wrong, but I'm waiting for, wait, what's his solution? Here in Minnesota, we're so optimistic, we walk on water half the year. The fact is, the states really do have to do these things. You see, what Tim Walz and all the crazy progressive leftists do in Minnesota really is up to Minnesota. Donald Trump would let the... I mean, this is actually an endorsement of Donald Trump. Well, Donald Trump lets the states operate here because that's what they're supposed to do. Hilarious. Walz just admitted Donald Trump is following the constitutional procedures that are there. The president isn't a dictator and can't unilaterally do these things. So he's just said, this is why you should vote for Donald Trump. Case closed. Right? Case closed for Donald Trump. I mean, Tim Walz should just campaign for him. Well, Donald Trump spends his time tearing down states rather than lifting up the things we do, the best of it. Donald Trump's critiques of that not only are that they are wrong, but I'm waiting for, wait, what is his solution? What is his solution? Well, in Minnesota, you can be Minnesota. That's the solution. That's the answer. All right. The end of the piece is right there, but it shows you this is the worst interview you could ever have on 60 Minutes for a left-wing candidate. Usually they just throw softballs. Whitaker did a great job not throwing softballs, being very critical, and I think if you really objectively looked at this, it's a disaster. Now, is it going to matter to half the population? No. Is it going to matter to low-information voters? No. But anybody with a brain watching this, and hope maybe some undecided voters will say, oh my gosh, we want to elect this person? Come on. Their only response is, well, we're not Donald Trump. That's their campaign. Vote for us because we're not Donald Trump. I mean, they should just say that. Doesn't matter what we believe. Doesn't matter what we think. We're not Donald Trump. On the other hand, they can't really point to anything positive about anything they've done. All right. See you next time with the Brion McClanahan Show. See you then.